Greetings, beloved of God. Are you excited? I am. We are journeying in anticipation and excitement to meet the Messiah once again, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We journey as we worship him by reading the scriptures promising his birth. We journey as we sing the songs proclaiming him Lord of Lord and King of King. We journey as we embrace the peace, hope, love, and joy only he can give. So welcome. Welcome to journey home with us. Home is salvation. Home is grace. Home is Jesus. Please join me in a prayer of thanksgiving written by Michael Perry. Praise be to you, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for your great mercy in giving us birth into a new life and a new hope by raising Jesus Christ from death. Praise be to you, our God and Father, for an inheritance that can never spoil or fade, kept for us in heaven. Praise be to you, our God and Father, for the protection of your power, ours through faith until salvation comes at the end of time. Praise be to you, O our God and Father. To be all praise, glory, and honor through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Our opening song tonight is Lo, How a Rose E'er Blooming.
Share all every load.
We are in the third week of Advent. It's a union every time we go home, every time we embrace those we love, no matter how long it has been. It feels like sunrise, like the clouds are parting and the rain has ended. It is joy, nothing less than pure joy to grab hold of those who are home for us, who make home for us, whether we wake up to them every day or travel many miles to see them again. It is joy to go home. The prophet Zephaniah tells us to rejoice at the thought of going home. The prophet tells us to imagine being set free, being unburdened, being released to live, to fully live in the grace and wonder of life itself. Surrounded by those who love us like no one else, and then to live like that was our truth even now, even here, it is joy to go home. John the Baptist reminds us, however, that it takes choices to live in this joy. It doesn't just happen. We choose to make life a joy by how we love others, by how we serve and give and care for others, by how we do the job we do, and how we impact the world around us. We build joy as we build a home in this world and the next. We light these candles, the candle of hope and of peace and joy, as a sign that we are on our way home, and we walk with a skip in our step because we see the destination and it is pure joy. It is time to go home.
If I were
a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. Get what I can, I give him.
Today's scripture is 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 17 through 21, and I will be reading from the Message version. You call out to God for help, and he helps. He's a good father that way. But don't forget, he's also a responsible father and won't let you get by with sloppy living. Your life is a journey you must travel with deep consciousness of God. It costs God plenty to get you out of that dead-end, empty-headed life you grew up in. He paid with Christ's sacred blood, you know. He died like an unblemished sacrificial lamb. And this was no afterthought. Even though it has only lately, at the end of the ages, become public knowledge, God always knew he was going to do this for you. It's because of this sacrifice Messiah, who God then raised from the dead and glorified, that you trust God, that you know you have a future God. The word of God for the people of God.
Amen. Thank you, Marie. It's good to have Jim back with us. You've been missed, Jim. We are grateful for your return. Just very briefly, Marie read to you 1 Peter 1, 17 through 21, and she read to you the Message version. I love the vernacular of the Message version because it makes it very plain and you understand exactly what's going on. But since I'm going to reference some points in New International Version, permit me to read very quickly 1 Peter 1, 17 through 21. Since you called on a father who judges each man's work impartially, live your lives as strangers in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Let us pray. Oh, I come humbly before you, Father God, for you are the head of my life. Lord, when I think about my life and how I am such a huge sinner saved by grace, I am humbled and grateful that you still chose me to be a vessel to speak forth life, truth. Lord, thank you for looking beyond my faults. Thank you, Lord, for choosing me to be your servant. Thank you, Lord, that you unconditionally love me, all of your children. So now, Lord, I come before you to be used once again, for you are an awesome God, a mighty God, and I love you so much. So, Lord, here I am, all of me, none of you, less of me, more of you, none of me, all of you. I come before you emptied. Fill me, Lord. Fill me. In the name of Jesus, amen. Well, Marie has read so beautifully that scripture that talks to us about God being our Father. But I want to take you back a little bit farther, okay? And I'm going to take you all the way back to Adam and Eve. And Adam and Eve in the garden. Eve listened to the serpent. Adam listened to Eve. thereby bringing sin into the world. That's where the fall of humankind first occurred, and the image of God was fractured. Not that God had done anything wrong, but humankind had done something wrong. Mankind had done something wrong because he had disobeyed God, and sin had entered the world. So because we were born in sin now and shaped in iniquity, and all this sin is all over and it's all around us, we're not clearly seeing the image of God, because God is a holy God. God is without fault. So the image of God was fractured, and the relationship with God was broken. Can you imagine what it would have been like to live in a place that was so beautiful? And you didn't have to work, you didn't have to do anything, and everything that you needed was there provided for you, and you didn't have to pay. But they messed it up. Our ancestors, our forefathers messed that up for us. And by our actions, God's image was distorted. We were turned away from God's standard, and we began to make our own path. We began to journey on our own. So when Maria is talking about in the Advent reading that we are on a journey during Advent, and that we are on a journey home, well, you know, many times Christians said that this is not my home. I'm a foreigner in this land. I'm an alien. My home is in heaven. And that is referenced throughout Scripture, with even Jesus saying that we have a mansion in heaven. And that is, heaven is our home. So if we look at heaven as being our home and we are journeying here on earth, then we are walking every day towards that place that we call home. Home for eternal life. Home is salvation. Home is joy. Home is peace. Home is not ever being sick. Isn't that something? That is something to really get excited about and to actually think about. So when we look at 1 Peter, and then we look at what happened in Genesis, we have to know and believe that God had a plan. Now, ever since I can remember, I was always told that God was omnipotent. God is all powerful. Amen? God is omnipresent. God is everywhere. But then we also were told that God was omniscient. That means God knows all things. So that tells me that in creation, at creation, when God created Adam, and before he even blew breath into his nostrils, he knew that Adam was going to mess up. Before he put Adam in that deep sleep and took that rib from him and formed woman, he knew that Eve was going to listen to the serpent. He knew that Adam was going to listen to Eve. And he knew that there would be the fall of humankind and sin would enter the world. But the word of God tells us in Peter, who was written by Apostle Peter to the Christians, and they were both Jews and Gentiles living in Asia Minor at that time, under the rule of Nero, that God had a plan. I want you to remember that. Remember that as you suffer persecution under Nero, as you suffer, I want you to know that even at the beginning of time, God knew what it was going to be like. God knew what we were going to experience and what was going to happen to us. So God had a plan for our salvation. God had a plan to fix the brokenness of the distortion of the holiness of God by humankind and their sin. You see, Christians are supposed to be different. We're foreigners in this land, but we're not supposed to look like everybody else that's living here. We're supposed to look a little different. Because our walk is different. Our talk should be different. We're serving God Almighty in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And that is exactly what we are being told in Peter. It opens up with talking about God being our Father. So it opens up with talking about a relationship with our Heavenly Father. And it talks about, I love the way that Marie read that when she said, now, yeah, God love you, but watch out now. Don't get it twisted. Just because he love you and he's God, he don't want you living sloppy. And that's where we're different. Yes, he wants us to live to glorify his name because we're his children. And the word of God, even in New International Version, tells you that we're going to be judged. And we have to be very, very careful. Now, with justice, sin has to be judged and we receive punishment. But with grace, our sins are pardoned and we are forgiven. So it is a way through God's plan for whatever we do and how we have sinned that God can still be just, but he still dispenses grace to us. Now, I don't know about you, but I have done so many things that if God was punishing me and there was no grace, I would have been taken out years ago. Oh, let me tell you, the punishment that I deserve and that I should have received may have been so heavy and so bad that I probably may not have been able to survive it. But because of the grace of God, because God had a plan, because God knew what we were going to do, that he had a plan for Jesus. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We're now in the Advent season, walking towards the celebration of the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that is something to get excited about when the word that was read tells us that God loved us so much that he had a plan for us. And that plan wasn't just for today. God loves Jim so much. And because God is omniscient, God knows what Jim is going to do tomorrow, even though Jim doesn't know himself. God knows what Marie is going to do next week. And Marie has no idea some of the things she's going to do next week. God knows what I'm going to do next month. And Gina is wondering what's going to happen tomorrow. No less talking about next month. God knows every thought that Barb has for the rest of the day. And she hasn't even any idea what she may think. So God is omniscient. He knows all these things. He knows what we're going to do. He knows what we're going to think. He knows what we're going to feel. And I want to let you know that because he loves us so much, he doesn't love us any less today than he did then when Christ came into the world. God has a plan for each one of our lives. He has a plan to prosper us. He has a plan for healing. He has a plan for health. He has a plan for prosperity. He has a plan for anything that we need, but we need to glorify him. We need to praise him. We need to honor him. He is our heavenly Father, and he will dispense discipline. Now, all of us sitting here right now, between the four of us, all of us are parents. And I'm telling you, when we were raising our kids, we had to discipline them. Because we didn't want them to grow up like a heathen, right? Now, if we loved our children so much that we had to discipline them so that their behavior would be corrected, how much more God loves us that we think he won't discipline us? You know, this stuff going around to my, oh, God is a good guy. God won't do this and God won't do that. Yes, he will discipline you. Yes, he will. God wants us to live a righteous life, but because of grace, we don't receive all the punishment and discipline that we should receive. But whenever we do receive any discipline, we got to know it's for our good. God is allowing it or God is dispensing it because when we receive it, if we accept it and look to the hills from which cometh our help, then we are going to grow. We're going to develop. We may become more spiritually mature, or we just may become a better Christian, a better person, a better husband, a better wife, a better child, a better somebody. But if God allowed it, it is definitely for a purpose that he actually allowed it. He is going to judge our actions. That's what the scripture said when she read it. He's going to judge our actions, but he judges us impartially. In other words, he does it with fairness. And Jim is going to go out there and mess up. Well, God is not going to judge me based on what Jim messed up and did. No, he does it individually. He does it impartially. He does it with fairness. But he also does it with grace. Hallelujah. He does it with grace because I'm not getting everything I deserve when he does it with grace. And I actually thank God for that. And you know something, what we need to remember, that
if we truly believe that God is omniscient and omnipotent and omnipresent, that he's everywhere, he's all-powerful, and he knows all things, then it would make sense if we try to seek out God's plan for our lives. If we try to seek out what God's purpose is, what God wants us to do. Because, you know, we mess up. I don't know about you, but I know I messed up. I had some times when my plan was different from God's plan. I wanted to do A, B, C, and D, and it looked like, I don't know, God, do you want me to do that? Well, I think you're not saying no, so I'm going to go ahead on and do this. And it was something I really wanted to do, and it was my plan. And when it backfired and it messed up, then I want to get mad and angry. Well, God, why didn't you stop me? Oftentimes, God is trying to stop us, but we don't hear it, or we're so bent on doing what we want to do that we ignore the voice of God telling us to stop. So there are four plans, okay? There's our plan. We want to do what we want to do. There's the enemy's plan, because the word of God said he has come to steal, kill, and destroy. So know that the enemy has a plan for each one of our lives, because he does not want us to prosper in the Lord. He does not want us to know the joy of the Lord, the peace of God. He does not want us to hope by Jesus Christ or in Jesus Christ. So he's going to do everything that he can to further distort the image of God, fracture our relationship with him, so that we will not have the fullness of everything that God has for us. He has come to kill, steal, and destroy. Then other folks got plans for us. Have you ever listened to somebody and they tell me, you know, if I was you, I wouldn't do that? Now, I know it ain't my business, then why are you talking? It ain't my business, but let me tell you, people going to look at you real funny if you do that. They're going to talk about you. You want folks talking about you? They tell you some all kind of things, and where you were sure what you were going to do before you started talking to them. After you finish talking to them, you're doubting yourself. You're doubting your plan. You might be even doubting that you heard the voice of God. So, those are the three. Our plan, the enemy plans, and the other folks' plans. But then there is the fourth plan. And the fourth plan is God's plan. And God's plan is always the best plan. And you know, when we follow in God's plan, then we are staying and living in God's will. Okay? And when we're in God's will, we have God's full protection, full grace, full mercy, full compassion, full rewards, you know? Don't you know and believe that God rewards those that diligently serve him? It ain't about what I want to do. It's all about what God wants me to do. Gina is nothing in the grand scheme of things. I'm only worthy through my relationship with Christ, who sits on the right hand of the Father, interceding for me. If it had not been for Christ's birth, death, and resurrection, woe would be Gina. Woe would be all of us. So, as we journey during this Advent season, we need to remember in this journey that we belong to God, and our purpose, one of our purposes, is to glorify God. As we journey through this Advent season of remembering, Christ has already been born. So we're not celebrating going to Christmas Day and go, "Woo, Christ has finally been born." No, Christ has been born. But we are remembering. We are celebrating. We are recognizing his birth. He is the reason for the season. He is the reason for salvation. He is the reason for eternal life. He is the reason for grace. He is the sacrificial lamb that took away the sin of the world. So when we journey, then we recognize God had that plan when he knew what Adam and Eve was going to do, and he loved us so much. So I want to let you know that he didn't just send Jesus to die for one or two folks. He didn't send Jesus to die for folks that walk around claiming to be holier than thou. You know, some folks claim to be, they ain't never sinned and never did nothing wrong. He didn't come to just die for them. He came to die for all of us. No matter how bad or how horrible it is that you've done, he died for you. He died for me, a sinner among sinners, because God had the plan and he loved us that much. And as we journey to remember the birth of Christ, I ask, I plead with you to allow that remembrance to burst forth in your spirit, where you will experience salvation as you have never experienced it before. That joy will be ever-resting and just bubble up inside of you, and you will experience and know the joy of the Lord, that you will feel the peace of God that surpasses all understanding from the top of your head to the sole of your feet, and that you will know that you're walking in mercy, you're walking in grace, and you're walking in compassion, because God had a plan even at creation that has not ended, that is still going on. God still has a plan. God still loves us. God still adores us and desires us to magnify his holy name. The precious blood of Christ, the Lamb of God, who took away the sins of the world. Yes, God is very gracious without compromising his justice. We have choices and we make choices. And these choices should always bring glory to God. You all, we are living in crazy times. We're living in real crazy times now. Who would have thought the pandemic would have been still going on this long? We're living in times where people are angry with one another, fighting one another. But it's time to go back. It's time to go back and say, Father, we need you like we've never needed you before. Oh, Lord, let that plan expand in our spirit so that we will go out and shed love abroad. Lord, let that plan expand in our spirit so that those that don't know you, we can witness to them about you. And they will come running to the cross saying, oh, Lord God, what must I do to be saved? Lord, take these little bitty eyes out of our spirit and replace it with the huge you, because it is all about you. Oh, Lord, it's never about us, but it's all about glorifying your holy name, glorifying who you are, praising who you are, worshiping who you are. For, Lord, you are the giver of life. You are the giver of every blessing. You are the giver of all things that we ask for and we seek, because you give it all. You give it all, Lord. How dare us? How dare us walk around like we bless ourselves? Everything comes from God. How dare us walk around and not use our gifts for God to glorify him? The choices we make, God looks at. God looks at every thought. He looks at every deed. He looks at everything we do. We better make sure that what we do, we're doing it to glorify him. We better make sure that whatever we do, we're doing it out of love. We better make sure whatever we do it out of obedience. One of the things that truly grieved my spirit is to hear people walk around and misquote scripture. They've heard a little something somewhere, and then they start living that misquote. Well, let me tell you, God is going to hold you accountable for any lack of knowledge and any misquote. For in the time that we're living in, everybody could have read the word of God. Everybody could understand the word of God, all the different versions they got. Now with King James Version, I can understand why people say, I don't understand what is being said. But there are versions now that a child can read it and can come away knowing what the word of God is saying to them. There's no excuse with radio, television, YouTube, Facebook, even TikTok, that we don't get the word of God and understand what God wants us to do, that we can't grab a hold to the plan of God and walk out our salvation as we glorify God and worship his holy name. God is a mighty good God. I don't know, someone may accidentally come upon this video. Or someone may be listening that is doubting. I want to let you know that if you don't have Jesus, it's not too late. You can get him now. Confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and you shall be saved. All you have to do is confess your sins. Father, I have sinned and I have sinned against you. That is the word of God. When we sin against God. So you come before him saying, Lord, I have sinned. I have sinned against you, but Lord, I desire eternal life. I desire to be part of that plan. So, Lord, I come telling you that I believe in Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I believe that Jesus is the Messiah. I believe that he was born in Bethlehem and died on the cross for my sin, but didn't stay dead, that he rose with all power and authority in his hand. I believe, Lord, and I ask that you forgive me of all my sins and Jesus come into my heart and live. And you're saved. And then you walk under the protective, humongous umbrella of grace. Isn't that something? Every time I think about grace, every time I think about what could be happening to me, but because of grace, because of Jesus, it hasn't happened, it's not happening. And because of it, I have eternal life. And because Jesus sent the Holy Spirit, when I don't feel like going on, the Holy Ghost stand in me and pick my foot up and push it forward and move me ahead. When I don't feel like worshiping, I start feeling a little moving down in my spirit. And next thing I know, I'm singing and praising the Lord. Oh, where would I be if it wasn't for God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit? Oh, yeah, God had a plan, y'all. God had a plan for our lives, and that plan is still in existence today. That plan is still available for all who want it, and that plan is magnified to all of us that already have it. Yes, we're celebrating the birth of Christ. This Jesus is the reason for the season. And there are happy holidays to me. It's Merry Christmas. Merry Jesus. Hallelujah. That's why I'm celebrating it. So why do I have to change it and make somebody else, make myself feel bad so somebody else can feel good? Does that make any sense? Whatever you want to say, fine, but let me say what's in my spirit. Jesus is the reason for my season. He's the reason for my season every day that I breathe. Because I know that I cannot breathe without God. I cannot move and have my being without God. And I thank God for the plan that he had for us as fallen children, that we could restore our relationship with him, that we might be reconciled with him by accepting Jesus Christ and the atoning act that he did for us on the cross. So, Lord God Almighty, I thank you for this season. Oh, Lord God Almighty, I thank you for Jesus. Oh, Lord, I thank you for the journey that we are on, that I am on. I thank you, Lord, for sanctification. I thank you, Lord, for grace, mercy, and compassion. Because, Lord, I know I mess up. I know I mess up. But, Father, because of your grace, because of Jesus dying on the cross, I am forgiven and justice is not dispensed according to my sins and what I need. I don't get the punishments, but God, I thank you, I love you, and I praise your holy name. Help me, Lord, to live more faithfully. Help me, Lord, to live more like a child of God. Help me, Lord, to be the servant that you call me to be and push Gina out the way and let God, Jesus, the Holy Ghost be before me in everything I do to glorify you and witness to what a God will do for anyone that chooses to serve him. Now, Lord, I ask that you touch each person that has heard this message. Touch each person that if we know you, we will be renewed. We will be revived. Oh, Lord, let us experience a revival like we've never experienced before.
And if someone does not know you, let them feel a dwelling of the Holy Spirit, that they will know that they know that they know that they know that they are saved and that they're on the same path as the rest of us. Oh, Lord, send your Holy Spirit. There may be a baptism of the Holy Spirit all over the land so that there will be a change. Lord, I end by saying thank you for the plan. Thank you for looking beyond our faults and seeing our need. Amen.
Little town of Bethlehem. Oh, little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie above thy deep and dreamless sleep. The silent stars go by, yet in thy dark street shine the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. For Christ is born of Mary and gathered all above. While mortals sleep, the angels keep their silent watch of love. No mourning hearts together proclaim the holy birth. Though and praises sing to God our King, and peace to all on earth. How silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessing of his heaven. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in. Oh, holy child of Bethlehem, descend on us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us above.
Thank you, Jim. Oh, little town of Bethlehem. Aren't you glad God had a plan for our lives, that we don't have to suffer under eternal punishment? And I tell you, I don't know, I'm glad. I'm glad about it. Our messages over YouTube are not lectionary based.
However, our in-person worship on Sunday mornings at 9:45 are all lectionary-based, and they're a little bit different. I kind of exegete the Word of God, and we get into the Word of God more, and these are pretty much topical based on what God is giving me to speak. So I pray that whoever this message was for today, be it 1, 2, or 22, that your spirit is open and your heart open, your mind open to receive that which God is saying to you today. And I'm the first person that's on that altar of receiving what God is saying to me. We invite you, as always, if you are in the area, to come and worship with us in person at 9:45 at Cascade United Methodist Church in Deerwood, Minnesota. We would love to have you with us. What is your challenge for this week? Simply, receive the plan. Receive the plan. If there is any doubt, do it now. Accept our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and come and begin a different journey, a journey filled with abundant life, grace, and mercy. Now, Lord God, we lift up every person under the sound of my voice, speaking blessings upon them this week, good health. And to the Lord God Almighty, who is our Creator, our Heavenly Father, we place ourselves in your care that we will be protected and provided for. May you shower the love from above upon each and every one of us, that we may feel your presence in all things that we do. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in peace. Amen. Amen.
It came upon the midnight clear. It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of old, from angels bending near the earth to touch their hearts of gold. Still this late.